higher education in its kind of basic model is not designed to disciple students.
Welcome to the Building Faith Families podcast with Steve Demme. I'm your host, Scott Moore. Thanks for joining us today. Good morning, Steve. How are you?
I am well, Scott. How are you doing today?
Fantastic. 25 Good. Years and one day now into my marriage.
Yes. Congratulations on your anniversary. I've been following you on Facebook, and I didn't know who the young guy and the cute girl were. Okay. I knew who the cute girl was, but I didn't know who the young guy was married to her. So.
Yeah, I definitely married up, so it's been a win
most
for
of
me.
Us have. Okay, so this morning, we're going to have a friend named Zac Northern, and I'm trying to remember exactly how I met him. I think we met at church, and then we found out we had a lot in common because he used to work at Grove City College, where I attended, and he knew my best friend, Andy, who's still on the staff at Grove City College. And the more we talked, I was intrigued by what he's doing today. I'm going to let him tell you all about it, but it's an alternative to when you graduate from high school. And if I was graduating from high school, I would do this. It sounds fascinating to me, but I'm going to let Zac tell you about that. But before we go any further, let's pray. Father, thank you for another opportunity to learn about different aspects of your kingdom and ways that you are moving and working. And I'm grateful for how I've been edified by talking to Zac and about what they do at the Gap Year program. But I pray that you will give us all ears to hear what your spirit is talking to us today. In Jesus' name, amen. Okay, so I'm going to introduce Zac Northern. And Zac has two daughters. I get to watch them in church coloring if I sit behind them. He's got a pretty wife, and we attend the same church in Lancaster, Pennsylvania. And Zac is in my book that I wrote, Stewardship, as an alternative to just running off to college or trade school, but it's a gap year program often called. But I don't want to say too much because I'm going to make a mistake. So, Zac, welcome to our broadcast.
Hey, Steve. It's good to be here.
So tell me about how you found out about One Life Path, and tell me what you do, and then I'll try to break in without overlapping and ask you some questions.
Yeah, sounds good. So a few different things here. One, for starters, my official position is site director of One Life Institute at Lancaster. We have four different locations on the East Coast. We have, and I'll talk a little bit more about that, but we are a gap year program, as you mentioned, and there are different types of gap year programs out there. So I'd love to talk a little bit more as we go about what makes ours distinct as an alternative form of education after high school. So I'm sure we'll get into that. But in terms of how I got into this, connecting back to your comment about your friend at Grove City College, I had been working there and at some other very high quality premier Christian institutions throughout my time in higher education, and I really loved it. I enjoyed it. I was doing some campus ministry work as well as some teaching and some student life and leadership responsibilities. And through the course of about 10 years at different schools, I tried to figure out what is the role of higher education in discipling a student. And over time, I came to realize that higher education in its kind of basic model is not designed to disciple students in the way that discipleship happens. But they are really good at forming Christian worldview, helping people think about knowledge and industry from a biblical perspective. However, discipleship of the whole heart, mind, and body happens in a little more nuanced, more incarnational way. And so for me, I experienced in those 10 years of working in higher ed, that we were graduating students who weren't as mature, who weren't as solid in their faith, or who weren't as able to take on the challenges of the world as I had hoped they would be. And so I had interacted actually with a few students at each institution that were just markedly different than others in my time. So encountering hundreds and thousands of college students, I had encountered a few, a handful of, at each. And what made them distinct was that they were better communicators. They were more self-aware. They were more others aware. They were more basically mature in their faith, understood what the gospel was and how it applies to life. And they had a little bit more, you could say, maybe purpose in their education, as opposed to just going to school because it's the right thing to do culturally. And what I learned about these students is that they all had done gap year programs. And so for me, that got me thinking, man, I really want to be a part of forming students in that way. And so I knew eventually that meant changing industries, going from higher education into the gap year industry. And so there was an opportunity that arose out here in Lancaster. One Life was just starting, and I knew some people from past work, and we got connected. And now we've been going on for 7 years. One Life Institute is 7 years old.
Can you just describe a little bit what, actually, I'm intrigued by this because I feel like in my own spiritual journey, I'm just doing those same things. So I guess I'm a slow learner. But I liked what you said about communication because now I do workshops on communication. I wrote a book on it. And being self-aware, I might even add a synonym, I think, able to reflect, able to be still, and then mature in their faith and more of a sense of purpose. Boy, all of those things I aspire to myself. So what's a gap year look like? How do you develop those skills?
Yeah, good question. As I mentioned before, there are different types of gap year programs out there. There are educational focused ones. There are ones where you just kind of go off and travel. And no matter what type you do, research has come around to the point where, well, and actually the past two presidents have had their daughters or children go through gap year programs. So everybody's kind of getting a little more excited about it and open to the idea about them. But for us, how we develop those skills combines a lot of different things. So for one, our program focuses on three primary things. We focus intently on forming Christian character. We also focus on helping students develop clarity around a biblical sense of calling. And then we want them to develop relational wisdom, which really focuses in on that self-awareness, others' awareness, and God awareness in the process of how I navigate myself in this world. So, yeah, we do a lot of things. We have classes, and students get 30 credits throughout 9 months. We serve locally. We travel internationally. We travel even locally on the East Coast. We do some camping and hiking. Students have leadership opportunities within the year to lead committees and to lead their peers in other ways. Then students, really the heart of it is students get discipled by our staff on a weekly basis. And we're attending to just things that matter. Like character and calling and relational wisdom. So while you might encounter those things throughout the course of your life and grow in them naturally, we are kind of hyper-focused on those for 9 months. And so I think that's kind of where I'd start of how we do things.
That sounds wonderful. So you say you travel internationally. Where might that be?
Yeah, so in the past, we have gone to Italy. We've done England. And then the past 4 years now, we've stuck to Israel. We really like Israel because there's really no place like it on the planet in terms of history, cultural learning, and then just kind of understanding of conflict and how the gospel speaks to even the current conflicts out there. And then obviously the rich biblical history of just seeing some of these places in the Bible and realizing just how much our story is a true story, and that it just builds your faith. So that's really helpful. Students really love that. So
how many students are in, I don't know what you call it, a class? Because it's a one-year program. So do these students go through the whole thing together as a team?
Yeah, so we try to keep the number somewhere between 24 and 32. And they're with each other the whole year. So as I mentioned before, we have four different sites. And so at each of those sites, you'll find about 24 to 32 students. And what's different about our gap year program than, say, perhaps a traditional Christian higher education is, instead of going off into college in your freshman year, you would come to our program for 9 months, same as a traditional freshman year program. But the difference, the main difference, is that you're going to be taking all of the same classes together. So you're going to be reading all the same books and having the same conversations and Bible studies. And then you're going to be going on the same trips and doing the same reflective practices. And so you share all of these experiences with the whole group. And so we have about half guys and half girls. And so you learn very quickly in that type of environment where you're sharing all of those things together, things about yourself that perhaps you don't want to see, but can be revealing and helpful to learn about and to see God's way in the course of the issues that you learn about yourself, as well as how to relate to others in love and compassion. And so the community of our program is really, to some degree, the secret sauce of what makes the learning so fun and difficult at the same time. Students learn also pretty quickly that community isn't something that you find, but it's something that you develop, and you develop it with biblical wisdom. So, yeah, it's a keystone for us.
So I'm assuming that a bunch of lifetime friendships are being made here, number one. But I'm also intrigued, what do the kids do? You must have some data now. You've been at this for 7 years. What percentage of kids do what, and how much do they keep in touch with each other, if you know that?
So the lifelong friendships, for sure, I think that's forming and continues to form. We try to do some alumni events here and there, locally, and then just geographically, depending upon where people are. So we like to keep people connected. And then in terms of the ongoing kind of alumni base, there's quite a big network now. And so our alumni do all types of things. But in terms of the percentage breakdown over the course of the past 6 years, it's looked something like this. Probably about 50% of our students, when they leave One Life, they go on to a traditional four-year education. And so they're going into that education as sophomores. And so they've gone to, you know, Christian schools, whether it's Geneva or Grove City or Messiah or Eastern, Palm Beach Atlantic, all these types of schools. But they've also gone to secular state schools like Penn State, Michigan, and places like that. Also, what comes to mind, Liberty and George Mason, we had two students go to last year. So that's about 50% of them. And some of them actually now are even in graduate school going on to get their graduate degrees in medicine or computer science and things like that. So that's always fun. So that's about 50% of them. Another 25 about will go on to a two-year school or a tech-related job, or maybe a trade job, where it could be a community college or just something specific for about a year and a half or 2 years. And then another 25%, we would see they've gone into just the working world. They've formed a network from our alumni networks, and they're working in business or realty or the hotel industry. Or, you know, we've actually had an alumni start their own business in downtown Lancaster. So yeah, there's all sorts of things that people do, but that's usually how it breaks down.
That's wonderful. I mean, all of my sons, I have four boys, and my three older boys, they were at least 20 when they went to college. And I always felt that it gave them a kind of unfair advantage, if I can put it that way. They were more mature, they more focused, they knew what they wanted to study. They either stayed home for an extra year because we homeschooled them, or they went to our church at the time we were affiliated with. They had a Bible school. So that gave them a chance to kind of get on their own a little bit and deepen their faith and not be, you know, living in our home. And so when they went to college, I think that they really got a lot more out of it. So that's why, I mean, I love this concept of the One Life. Where did you get the name One Life?
I was not a part of creating that name, but the idea is that life is fragmented. And it's very tempting to believe that you have different lives. You've got your church life, you've got your work life, you've got your relationship life. But our faith says that life is integrated, and the gospel speaks to all areas of life. And so we want students to realize that there is one life, there is one call, and there is ultimately one purpose. And so if they can catch a vision for that, they'll understand that you can do anything and participate in the mission of God's kingdom and restoring all things, no matter what you're doing. And so our students, I would say, leave One Life, obviously deepened in their faith, but with a vision and more purpose of how to be a lifelong learner. So they're going to college with a little more intent and what they want to study and how that's going to benefit their neighbor. Or they're going into the business field with how to love their neighbor with their business dealings. So the idea is there's one life that we're called to, and we're called to steward that well.
Amen. That's some of the topics in my stewardship curriculum, which I still haven't given you one, but I'm going to get you one. I have a question.
That'd be great.
I have a question that says, is it more spiritual to be a pastor or a plumber? And even though I know that you're not supposed to answer one or the other, in my heart of hearts, for many years, I believed the pastor would win that answer. And God used having my own business and becoming an entrepreneur to balance me out along that line, because whether we eat or drink, we do all to the glory of God. So thank you for that. Okay, so is there something that you forgot, or something that you'd just like to add one zinger for us? What else would you like to add? Closing comments.
Yeah. Well, I think it's difficult I want to speak to the parents and the students who might be listening to this, that it's very difficult to make decisions about what you're doing next after high school. It's a scary time. There's a lot of uncertainty. There's a lot of unknowns. And so we get that. And, you know, for us, we really understand the vulnerabilities of growing up in our culture. We understand the things that are impacting students around technology, around sexuality, around relationships, and just trying to make sense of the world and understand why things are the way they are. So that's a difficult time, and research shows that the years of 18 to 21 are the most critical in your life, that you're making decisions about who you are, who you want to become, and who you want to surround yourself with for the rest of your life, and that these things will shape you. You know, the decisions that you make during this time will shape you. And so I guess we just want to say that don't take this decision lightly, that we would want you to consider taking an alternative path. Sometimes the best way forward is a step back, or actually I'd rather say a different path. And it's really comforting to say, hey, after high school, I'm going to go on the traditional path of college. And that's really easy to say to family members when they ask you, what are you doing? You can tell them, yeah, I'm going to college. I know what I'm doing. I'm doing what everybody else is doing. So, you know, hey, let me go. And so there's some security in that. However, again, 85% of people at the age of 18 after high school do not have a clear vision of where they're called to be and go in the world. And quite frankly, I think the other 15% are just lying that they do. So you might as well take a step back and consider how taking a different path can put you on a trajectory for life where you have formed deep character, a deep sense of calling, and deep relationships. These are things we long for, but they don't come naturally. We have to pursue them. And so sometimes that means taking a different path than what's traditional. So I think that's all I'd say. It's a tough time, but we'd love to get to know parents and students who are willing to take a different path to solidify those things in their life.
Well, how can they follow up if they want more information? Where do they go? What do they do?
Yeah, so you could start by going to our website. Our website is www.onelifepath.org. That's onelifepath.org. There you can find all the information you'll need about our program. You can even get in touch with some of our admissions folks who can answer any questions you might have. Or you could see my email there, as well as the other sites that we have on the East Coast, and just kind of look at them. But yeah, the website will explain kind of how the program breaks down and how we do what we do. So that's a good place to start for sure.
Wonderful. Zac, thanks so much for taking time. I know you had some home emergencies that happened this morning, but we did it and we made it. And I'd like to close in prayer. Father, thank you for having us today. And thank you for Zac's heart for helping these young people. We can sense it coming through in everything he says. And I pray that you will lead this next generation. Help us to live a well-ordered, well-effective, deepening Christian lives, and we can impact the kingdom in so many different levels. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
And that's our show for this week, folks. Thanks for joining us for the Building Faith Families podcast with Steve Demme. If you have a question for the show, email steve at spdemme@gmail.com. If you have a question for me, you can reach me at scott@unsocializedmedia.com. Thanks for joining us. Have a great week.